Broadcasting from the campus of Salisbury University, this is WSDL Ocean City, NPR News Talk 90.7, putting Delmarva first. It's time for Delmarva Today with your host, Don Rush.
So what would it be like if Delmarva was a single state? Welcome to Delmarva Today. This is Don Rush. As early as the Revolutionary War of 1776, sentiment for a separate state in Maryland was already in evidence. So writes Philip LaBelle. His new book, A Brief Relation of the State of Delmarva, traces not only the secessionist sentiments, but how historical forces have welded this peninsula into a community buffeted by the outside, but still keeping its deficits. Peninsula, for many years, was isolated from the rest of the country, even as it interacted with the great events of the nation in the 19th century. But these days, it has seen immigration by retirees as well as a growing Hispanic community. That promised to change the face of Delmarva. In our studio this morning is Philip LaBelle, who teaches occasional course here at Salisbury University and makes his home in Delmarva. And appreciate you coming on the program.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Well, let me ask you this about the idea of a separate state. There were, I guess, a number of secessionist movements. Tell me a little bit about that. What was the impetus for some of these?
The geographic isolation of the peninsula. Before the age of bridges that we all are familiar with and railroads connecting this area with the rest of the state and with the larger Atlantic seaboard coast, often gave people a sense of a separate identity. And so periodically there would be some declaration out of Annapolis by the legislature saying we're going to adopt this measure or whatever, and oftentimes these were seen at odds with interests of people who were very much dependent, for example, on poultry or on agricultural or seafood industries. And so that gave rise to a political impetus to have a separate state formed. Most of those gestures, as I point out in the first chapter, came out of Maryland. So it was the eastern shore of Maryland that drove it. But there was one instance where it actually came out of Delaware. And so this sense of identity was propelled by that feeling of not being considered in terms of the interests of the region, even though, as I also write in this book, for a time, Maryland enjoyed what I called a governance subsidy, which is to say they had a guaranteed seat in the legislature for someone from this region. But as I say, those days have gone by. And what we're living with today, in effect, is a dissipation of that sense of isolation as communications and technology are simply eroding what was once a much more distinctive place where people had a sense of regional and local identity.
So let's take us back a little bit. What did the peninsula look like with the Native Americans, and how did they spread across the peninsula? And was there a unifying factor with all the various tribes on the peninsula itself?
If you speak to anyone who is a resident Native American of the region, they will draw distinctions between, let's say, the Okahanok versus the Nanticoke versus the Delaware. So they were all part of the Algonquin larger Native American community. And as I also wrote in this in trying to track some of this, there was commercial trade, if you will, between those, particularly the Nanticoke, let's say, of the lower shore and the western shore. But oftentimes they were at odds with each other. And there were periodic eruptions of warfare, usually over property rights, fishing rights, and that sort of thing, between one group and the other. So as that evolved, I'm not sure how far you want to explore this, but with the arrival of European settlers, what that tended to do was decimate by disease the Native American population. And as we've also seen in the case of the Caribbean, when we had Native Americans being eroded by disease as well.
So was there some kind of common nature to these various tribes? Did they all participate in similar activities with the economic and so on and so forth, and they were just simply cultural splits? So was there a major difference in how, for instance, folks, say, lived in the northern part of the peninsula as opposed to the southern part in terms of what they did and how they related to one another, or was it?
There was a lot of similarity. These were primarily subsistence cultures. Yeah. They engaged in trade when there was an obvious deficit in something that was essential to their survival. What I'm thinking of are the use of stone flint points to be able to go in hunting. When you go down to the lower shore, as we all know, the alluvial soil just does not have any rock from which to make those carvings. And so the evidence of stones used for making flints really derives from trade with the western shore. And so the lower Native American populations in the lower part of the shore clearly had some trading relationships with the Western Shore. And we're dealing here with a pre, you know, literate culture where you don't have a written record. So that's the base in which we make an intuition about, well, we think that there certainly was some degree of trade. But what they shared in common was periodic agriculture, a regular dependence on hunting, and on harvesting seafood. So those things were pretty common for the whole region, just a plentiful source of food supply.
So, as you mentioned a moment ago, the Europeans arrive. The sense I get was that as they arrive, there's still these kind of divisions as they begin to settle in, people making different claims. Describe that, what's going on there in that pre-revolutionary period.
Well, with the arrival of European settlers, they also depended very much on subsistence, and they learned from the Native Americans. I mean, you know the famous narrative about what happened with the Pilgrims in New England, and they were saved because basically the Native Americans in that region were able to provide them a supply of food in the wintertime. These people were very poor in terms of knowledge as settlers of what could survive in the region, how would they cultivate certain kinds of crops. So as all of that arrived, you had two subsistence cultures existing side by side. But in keeping in common with European settlers and their own tradition, they were much more preoccupied with a European notion of property rights in comparison to what Native Americans did. So when they began to close off plots of land, this essentially disrupted the regional, sometimes transient pattern of hunting and gathering that the Native Americans would do. So if there were a herd of deer, for example, they might just simply pack up and move to where they saw the herd migrating at any one time. And with enclosure, essentially, it's an enclosure movement in this region, that's something that blocked off some of that trade, and it had adverse effects on the survivability of the local populations.
And then you had these granting rights from the king and so on. Did that divide up this particular area?
Yes, it did. I have a whole chapter looking at the way in which we had claims from Pennsylvania to the lower shore. That was what we think of as Delaware today, in effect, was claimed by William Penn and his successors for a while. And we also had conflicts between Lord Baltimore in terms of who would govern the lower shore. So we can think of William Scarborough, for example, who had challenged the rights. You go back to the time of William Claiborne, who, even prior to the founding of the colony of Maryland in 1631, add a trading operation up on Kent Island. So that preceded the formal declaration. So periodically there were overlapping claims as to who in effect would govern the region. And so after a while, there were agreements that were worked out that said, okay, the lower part of the shore would then constitute what are now the two colonies of Northampton and Accomack counties belonging to the colony of Virginia and then the state of Virginia. And eventually there was an agreement that was secured through the Mason-Dixon line agreement that Delaware would also be a separate colony until it then also, along with Maryland, broke away during the American Revolution.
So how does the American Revolution affect Delmarva? I mean, how active was the people involved in it, and were people divided on the peninsula?
People were definitely divided. A lot of people like to wrap themselves in a flag and have a patriotic narrative about, you know, how we resisted all the British incursions. But for a lot of local people, they saw that as a foreign issue. And for them, it was day-to-day survival and what opportunities existed for them to prosper through trade. So we have evidence. William Truett, I think, wrote a book years ago called Delmarva, Breadbasket of the Revolution, in which he noted the fact that for sure economic self-interested reasons, they would trade with the British as well as with the Americans. So it wasn't as though they were standing up and saying, we're going to win this fight. Now, I put that in a context in which there were clearly volunteers from Maryland who fought in the Battle of Brooklyn Heights, for example, with George Washington as he made his famous retreat over into Manhattan and was fleeing from the British. So we can construct various narratives about what were the sentiments and the sense of identity that people had, but the first thing that governed people's sense of well-being and identity was self-interest. And what that meant was, would a British blockade, for example, prevent them from engaging in opportunities for trade? And sometimes they were just simply saying, we're not here to decide the American Revolution. We're here to decide what are we going to put on the table for tomorrow.
Hmm. And, of course, one of the most famous Delmarvas, of course, is Cesar Rodney. What kind of role does he play?
Well, Cesar Rodney was someone who was we think of him as a patriot. He's involved with the American Revolution and the Declaration of Independence. But he also had a set of local interests, like a lot of people did at the time. And so he's one of those what I call a transitional figure, someone whose identity, like Ben Franklin's, for example, evolved with time. I won't call it opportunistic. I would simply say there was a time when the people said, okay, our greater self-interest lies in aligning ourselves with this Revolutionary War movement instead of trying to look at something else as an alternative and become good citizens of England.
So were the concerns, by the way, in terms of independence, particularly here, were they more of a practical nature rather than necessarily an idealistic nature?
That's my point. It's very practical, driven by immediate self-interest. Mm-hmm. I don't say that in a pejorative sense, but some people would say, self-interest is too narrow-minded, it's not civically engaged and things of that sort. I'm simply saying, put yourself in the shoes of those people during those days when you had absolutely no guarantees about the vagaries of weather or political vicissitudes that would take place. You're looking to your immediate self-interest, your family, your land, and how you were going to survive.
Now, let's turn a bit to the agricultural side of this, and particularly tobacco, which then turns into grains. Tell me a little bit about the development of tobacco, and does that spread throughout the entire peninsula and growing tobacco?
I think it's mostly the lower shore. If you think of Delaware, I mean, there's a whole section I devote to how the Dutch came along. You're thinking of Peter Minuit, who was kind of thrown out of the Dutch colony up in what we think of now as Manhattan. But for the rest of the lower shore, instead of fur trading, for example, which was a preoccupation, very early on they latched on to tobacco. Well, as I also point out in this, Maryland tobacco was different from the John Rolfe product that was cultivated that was known as sweet tobacco in Virginia. And as I point out, this harsher tobacco was something that the French actually liked. And when some of those sales began to expand, as King James I wrote his counterblast to tobacco, trying to restrain this wicked weed from being consumed in England, the French established their monopoly over the control of tobacco at that time because it was very strong. But as I also examine in the book, if we look at the limited evidence that we have on cultivation, I mean, you look at relative prices, the expansion of tobacco production throughout the Atlantic colonies was something that was driving down its price so rapidly that it became less and less viable for people to stay in that. So then they moved to another occupation, which was grains. And initially, grains simply were a supplement to a subsistence economy. But in these early days, we see that commodity booms, in effect, such as in tobacco and also in the case of grains, was something that propelled the economy forward. And people were able to enjoy at least momentary prosperity, even though the long-term prospects didn't look all that good.
So, I mean, because it seems to me that one of the things that's happening here, whether it's tobacco or grains for that matter, is that what you're really writing in on is basically a commercial revolution that's taking place at the time, because you have ships now that can go from place to place, and you have a commercial revolution which produces financial institutions and so on. And that seems to be the thing that that shifts then us from, say, a tobacco to grain. It's a much more broader. And so that the subsistence farming, for example, is not necessarily as important as it once was.
That's true. When you talked about the expansion of financial institutions, we could talk about Robert Morris, we think of as the financier of the American Revolution, but it was only in his youthful years that he was in Oxford and later on went to Philadelphia and made a fortune, including, as I understand it, he was not separate from the trade in slavery that occurred at the time, but he certainly made vast sums of money. But more to your point, if you look at financial institutions on the Eastern Shore, there was not a lot of banking and other kinds of financial institutions that had spread on the Eastern Shore. So still in its relative isolation, this subsistence economy perpetuated itself. As to trade, though, the kind of shipbuilding that was used in the region, and for a while was a very important industry, was something that was propelled by unique designs that could navigate the waterways so that this commerce could actually succeed.
So we mentioned a bit about slavery for a moment. How does slavery take hold in this peninsula, and how does it differ from, say, other parts of the country?
Well, if we go back, for example, to Edward Lloyd, who was one of the largest slaveholders in this region, if not in the United States, and it was instrumental, for example, in the early days of the founding of the Republic and so forth in terms of representation, Lloyd was typical of what we think of as a Southern plantation owner. Had a large number of slaves at one time, and all of that early expansion of slavery was driven around plantation holdings. But after a while, as tobacco cultivation became less and less attractive, what we had was a slowdown, and a lot of the slaves were sold off in markets in Virginia and in the Carolinas. And so those slaves that were still being held here and periodically negotiated in sales were largely for domestic field hand purposes. So the volume of slavery dissipated, but it created a foundation, if you will, of an African-American base to this region.
Because one of the things, by the way, that strikes me about the region is that not only do you have this group of slaves who are in the African-American community, but there is also a growing number of free blacks. I mean, and obviously the one that most people point to now is the Hill, which is in Easton, which is the longest continuous, I guess, free African-American neighborhood. Why is it that we get this sort of two by this bifurcated society where we have slaves on the one hand and free blacks on the other?
Well, there were a number of African Americans who learned how to read. They became politically aware of events taking place, and they were aware of a growing anti-slavery movement. And to the extent that they could get beyond the prejudice of denying them property-owning rights, they were able to establish successful businesses on their own. Now, I'm not going to say this was a bastion of African-American liberation, but what I did show in the book was to look at the percentage of the African-American population that was free, and that was on the rise, both in Delaware and also in the Eastern Shore of Maryland by the time of the Civil War. So what we had was a progression of that. Had the Civil War not taken place in this region, no doubt that would have continued. But that's not to say that without a war, we would have had complete emancipation. That became necessary, I think, with the events that we all are familiar with in terms of Lincoln's Declaration, freedom of emancipation, and so forth that attended all of those changes.
So how does the Civil War then affect this area? I mean, in many ways, when I've read about it, we almost seem set off aside, where there are these great events that are going on in Virginia and in Maryland and in Pennsylvania, but we seem to be kind of off to the side.
You might say somewhat irreverently, this real estate was not as attractive as other parts of the country, which is to say, people knew this as a regional area where you would have agricultural dependence, but it wasn't a center of manufacturing. It did not have great ports, let's say, the way Philadelphia and Baltimore had been evolving. And so, yes, the great battles were fought elsewhere. We have no great battle of any kind having been fought on the Eastern Shore. And yet there were residents of this region on both the north and on the southern side who fought in places like Gettysburg or Antietam or other locations. I would think that there was no strategic importance attached to the region, and for that reason, it was circumscribed, even though there were discussions about invading the region and somehow using that to secure advantage strategically of the Chesapeake Bay area. One thing I did want to add on this is that we look at the history of this region in terms of what went on militarily, and of course, we had Camp Upton, which was on the building now, a part of history of the former Delmarva Daily Times structure. But you notice that's right on the confluence of the eastern and northern branches of the Wicomico River. So when the Union forces, which had just had the advantage of a railroad completion all the way down to Salisbury, were able to rapidly move troops into the area from Camp Upton, they sent down a delegation down to the eastern shore of Virginia. Some people are familiar with this, but what that did, ironically, is prevented the eastern shore counties of Virginia, Accomack and Northampton, from joining with the rest of Virginia in secession from the Union. And it was that military force that made all that difference, and the railroad that was critical to its implementation.
How deeply divided was this peninsula in terms of...
Very divided. I mean, even today, you can look at Civil War reenactments, and you can see loyalties on both sides. You can look at individuals who are tracing their ancestry. I use that phenomenon to kind of explain why it is that we don't have many Civil War monuments around this region. You can go to Gettysburg and you can find monuments to both Confederate soldiers and to Union soldiers. But around here, because you had brothers often fighting brothers, it was a very divisive conflict.
Because one of the things that I know we've had a great discussion in Easton about the Talbot Boys and the whole idea that there are a large number of monuments to Civil War veterans put up probably about 50 years after the fact. Why is it, do you think, that we have this kind of predominance of the Confederate as opposed to the Union soldiers?
I think that predominance of the Confederate had to do with the rural nature of the region, that it viewed itself as being put upon, if you will, by outside forces, in this case the Union, and so they had their sentiment. To say that that was because they wanted to defend slavery is a little wanting, in my opinion, because although there were slaves here, it was not plantation slavery, and it wasn't something that was driven by exports of cotton, for example, in any large quantity. So in that sense, that Southern sentiment had more to do with their perception of how they didn't want to be intruded upon by outsiders. It gets back to the, sort of the states' rights argument as opposed to slavery. Together, if we look at the larger picture, we cannot deny that slavery was so central to the divisions that did attend to that, and it was not just a matter of states' rights. But down here, it wasn't as though they were upholding some vast plantation system.
Because it seems to me that the Bay Area, the peninsula, was not that deeply invested necessarily in slavery as a major component of the economy.
No. I mean, if you look at Lee's Battle of Gettysburg and first at Antietam, it was an effort to secure recognition by England and France in particular, not only to divide or bring the Union to the table for negotiation, but by getting recognition, they could continue with their export trade, which was so critical to them. And, you know, a lot of Americans say, you know, well, we look at these European countries as our friends, and yet in retrospect, when you realize they're willing to truck with a possible recognition of the South that makes you at least give pause, or it should give one pause about, you know, what is our foreign policy and what are our relations with the rest of the world.
So how do you see the development then of the peninsula after the Civil War? I mean, is it, I mean, we seem to have railroads and so on. Is there a certain amount of development that takes place? And does any of that development unify the peninsula at all?
Well, we certainly have the emergence of banks. I mean, you've made a couple of references now to Easton, and we have one of the older banks around 1867, thereabouts, being established among the earlier banks. Salisbury, I'm not sure what the earliest bank was, but there were a number of financial institutions. And so, yes, to the extent that there was a proliferation of financial institutions, it did begin to integrate the region with the rest of the U.S. economy. But in terms of the kind of trading relationships, we still have that perpetuation of this local subsistence kind of economy. And it remained largely rural because other kinds of communications didn't bring into a broader developmental pattern. The railroad was clearly an important part of that. Some towns prospered when a railroad came to that region and others died. You can think of Crisfield, for example, prospering momentarily when they had the railroad spur that was built from Crisfield to the north-south line. As long as seafood was plentiful, then that would help that community to prosper. Others simply became marginalized. If you think of Princess Anne, for example, while the railroad went down that way, the silting up of the Monocacy River is something. It kind of condemned it to a minority position that was marginalized against, let's say, the growth of Salisbury, which was able to secure deep water commerce on the river.
So, as a matter of fact, let's turn to the Chesapeake Bay, oysters and crabs, but particularly oysters. There was a tremendous amount of harvesting, particularly in the late 19th century. I think something 20 million bushels, I think it was, that they were talked about. Describe that development and the culture that created.
Well, the life of the waterman is part of the mythology of the region. People still look at it with a kind of romanticism because it embodies local self-sufficiency. It embodies at the same time a romantic vision of people tied to the land. It has a certain eco-friendly appeal, even though they were devastating the oyster beds at the same time. It spawned the growth of skipjack construction, which was a unique type of craft that lent itself to oystering in the region. But that dependence on seafood, both crabs and on oysters, is something that it certainly informs our cuisine of Delmarva. We think of the kinds of dishes that are unique to the region. But at the same time, it was something that was momentary because we did not have a sustainable set of practices in place. And so from those early days of harvesting, and I looked at some of the data that tell us about the size of those harvests, we've seen this sort of steady decline of both oysters and on crabs. I'm not sure how far you want to go with this, but one of the things that I noticed in more recent years is that when we finally got down to 100,000, 100, 200,000, let's say, bushels of oysters a year, and we put basically restrictions on where they could be harvested, that not only put a limit in terms of the future economic prospects of a skipjack, even with the restrictions that were placed on using motorized craft for dredging, but it also said something that, well, we need to have some kind of rebalancing. So as we did in the case of looking at rockfish, when we had a moratorium on them, we find that other seafood species come under stress. And so with the decline of oystering, we also then saw an accelerated harvesting of rockfish, but also of crabs. And one of the things that I came across in my own research on this is that when the rockfish moratorium was set up for about 10 years, all of a sudden crabs were under threat. And why is that? Because rockfish love nothing better than to eat little baby crabs. And so what we're looking at is coming to terms with what I call habitat management as opposed to single species management. And even with those things, we still face the challenge of how can we create a viable and sustainable Chesapeake Bay area for both recreational purposes, but also for commercial purposes, that might maintain some measure of livelihood for some of the populations that are living near those coastal ports.
So a large history of the peninsula has been really very much in isolation. And that begins to break down, or at least begins to shift, with a couple of bridges, obviously the most, perhaps the most significant being the Chesapeake Bay Bridge in 1952. How does that change the way Delmarva is, and what kind of reaction were we getting then from all these people beginning to come over, either as tourists, obviously, but also a lot of people then beginning to move into an area that, if you look around, for instance, at names of places, right, Parsons and Tillman and so on and so forth, you get a sense that they're families that have been here a long time, and the entire population seems to be intertwined in one fashion or another. But then when you begin to open up the bridge, then you start to get like new people coming in. Explain that dynamic to me.
Well, Definitely, the Chesapeake Bay Bridge, the first span. And I'm old enough to remember having taken the ferry across there. So I knew what that experience was like. But obviously, the bridge, not only on the Chesapeake Bay, the second span in 1972, and then the opening of the bridge tunnel, clearly brought in much more of an influx because it was more and more accessible for people coming from the outside, both, as you say, for pleasure, recreational purposes, and then also for relocation. So people would come here, they enjoy the natural settings, the opportunities for fishing and hunting, as well as the lovely beaches that are on the shore. So that would begin to transform the nature of the culture. If you were a member of a long-standing family tradition, and there are lots of these sort of proud families that date back to the Revolutionary War, or even before that time, sometimes you would look at askance at these, quote, foreigners. You know, you've heard this phrase about those who are come-here, stay-heres, and been-tos. And right. I think you are not from this region, so you'd be a come-here. I am originally from this region, but I lived away for decades and came back, so I'm a bintu. And then there are the stay-heres, people who never really left here. And that cultural mix is evolving. That was part of the subtitle of the book, because with the influx of people, not only do you see changes in language and cultural habits, but also in terms of how the economic will prosper. And one of the things that I'm trying to point out in this book is that in more recent decades, it is this influx of outsiders that has brought a lot of innovation to the region. They brought a different kind of entrepreneurial spirit and talent. And so while people adapt to the sometimes uncertain nature of who they are and where they come from, the upside of all of that is that a lot of times they're bringing new industries that were just not thought about. I mean, you look at the influx of or expansion of local craft brewing, for example, or you can look at Hal Perdue Farms, although it's a local family tradition, has hired talent from around the country, and they have brought a lot of innovations. Some people, maybe many people, know that Tom Sheldon used to be an executive with Perdue Farms, and he said in retirement, I'm going to go off and pursue my childhood dream, which is winemaking. And he now has a very distinguished winery, Bordeaux Winery, down on Paso Dike Creek. And so he's just an example of people coming in from another area and then setting up, if you will, industries that create employment, create new opportunities, but they also change the sense of identity that people have of the region.
Along that sense of identity, I mean, how does that, what do you think is the difference between somebody, say, who's grown up here, who's lived here, and embraces its traditions? How do they differ from, say, somebody who comes here? I mean, is there pushback from the people who were necessarily born here and they identify here? I mean, what is there any tension? What is there some areas where it might be more difficult, for instance, for, say, an outsider to come in and do something? What's that dynamic,
I'm
you
sure
think?
There is a bit of a challenge. And your question makes me think about, you know, who were those who were supporting the more recent secessionist initiatives? And I suspect, yes, there were probably some old line folks who lined up behind that idea saying, we're going to preserve our identity. You may have heard of those bumper stickers, welcome to the Eastern Shore, now go home, and there is no life west of the Chesapeake Bay, those kinds of things. That's kind of a romantic sentiment that appeals to a number of people about who they are and what they're about, but that's all changing with each of the new ones coming in. So when you say restrictions that may have been presented to them, I would say probably they face the challenge of how can I set up shop in this particular area or start a new industry in a way. I don't think the law has been hostile to outsiders right. coming in. It's just a matter of saying, well, will the community welcome it? And for those coming into the region, they have a selling job often to do by saying, you know, well, I'm also bringing the opportunity for jobs, for new products. Again, we could elaborate on some more of the examples. I'm thinking of a local man, Richard Bernstein, who was born in Chincoteague, Virginia, but he established Can-Am Microwave, winds up having defense contracts for the U.S. Defense Department. These are important initiatives because he himself had traveled around in different locations, and it brings an infusion of new energy into the region where new industries can display some of those that are being put by the wayside. And it brings more people out of that old, what I call the subsistence mindset of self-sufficiency, into this broader globalizing economy of which we're all a part.
But it's one of the things, by the way, I noticed when I first came here prior to the crash of 2008 is that there were a whole host of big, gigantic developments. Some developments would literally dwarf the towns that they were sitting next to. I mean, I think Hebron, I've said, had something like 1,600 people or whatever, but the town itself only had 400. And I remember discussing, I think it was the mayor, the idea, well, how does that change the dynamics of your town, because the majority of people moving in, if they had actually moved in, would outnumber the people who were actually originally there. I mean, is there, now obviously the housing industry, they went bust, so there are a number of these things did not get developed, but it does seem as if there was this move to, on the one hand, bring all these people in with these developments, and the other hand, there was, I don't know, the necessary lack of recognition and how these people would then change not only political composition, but even the cultural composition of these towns.
Yes, I think you're right. And you also could have a narrative about what happens to the downtown region of a particular community. Salisbury is just one example of this. You could talk about Cambridge or other places where you had a significant move outward into strip malls outside the immediate city limits. Then they would wind up being incorporated into the city limits. Yes, it does change the culture. But those who came in at a variety of different levels in terms of what they brought. When I say what they brought, I mean by their level of education, their skills, their experience, and their willingness to invest into the region. I want to give a little downside narrative to the expansion of the housing and say briefly that when you talk about the crash of 2008, one of the things that happened is that a lot of people lost their homes, which had a lot of foreclosures taking place. And there are people in these so-called new residences who used to be homeowners who wound up being renters because they simply could not qualify anymore for the kind of mortgages. And that gets to the critical issue of how do you maintain well-paying jobs in the community? How do you create them? So we need to probably think about how would you break out the composition of those new housing developments? How many of them are really coming in from outside, and how many of them are just being reshuffled around from once being homeowners to, in effect, becoming renters?
By the way, I'm going to ask you about the significance of Wallops, the Fly facility. I mean, we did a story a few years back in which there was a There was some new contract, and people expected there would be another expansion and that would bring lots of economic activity to the area. And the sense I got was that every few years you would get this sense that something new would happen, and therefore you would get this economic expansion. And then, yeah, there was some more activity, but not the kind that they expected, the extent to which they had expected. How significant is Wallops to the area? And do we, say, for instance, put too much pressure on the idea that it's going to bring something that's perhaps greater than it can?
Well, let's put it this way. Wallops probably has been a lifesaver for the immediate environs of Chincoteague, that much we could say. But it started basically as a base, an air base, in the Second World War. And so its experience with that, and then moving into the space age with having space exploration and balloons and so forth, has placed it in the position where some of that payroll is for people who, in effect, who are only temporarily working here, because that's the site from which you can do launches. So the amount of financial influx into the community, how that would transform it, is constrained to some extent by that people who are coming from the outside momentarily and working. I'm thinking if you go down the road to Chincoteague, you can see Northrop Grumman, for example, has had an office, and you look at other companies that are big-name companies, but not necessarily setting up major operations. And there's a way to kind of bounce this off. We know that down in Merritt Island, Florida, for example, and Port Canaveral, you've got the likes of Elon Musk looking for a recoverable reentry vehicle. And so, in a sense, there's been a bit of a competition between the Wallops space facility and what would happen down there. I know that anybody ever had the idea that this was going to become a new Port Canaveral, that we were going to actually have manned launches going up to the space station. But put that out of the equation for a minute. There's still important things that can be done, like deliverables to the space station. And so I see a positive future for Chincoteague. But whether it's going to be on the same footing, let's say, as Port Canaveral, that's hard to say.
I would ask one other group of people who I've noticed coming in, and that's the Hispanic community, particularly the immigrant community. How do you assess their impact on the peninsula? Because they've changed. There's a, for instance, in some of the old packing houses, or the old houses now where they deal with crabs and so on and so forth. I remember talking to one person who said Hispanic immigrants have, like, replaced them, right, as opposed to the old folks. What kind of impact do you see them having on this peninsula?
Well, I think contrary to some of the, what I would call, smearing that goes on about immigrants coming into the region, most all of them have been very hardworking, saving, and some of them even provide remittances to their families back in the Caribbean, countries from which they have come. And Mexico's not the only one. I know we're going to have a wall being built here to keep them out, in a way. But they have been critical to the success of the economy. And I don't think anybody pushed them out. I think that's the traditional workers out. I think as people got older, they looked for other economic opportunities, working in the service sector of the industry rather than in this stage of manufacturing, if you will, of food processing. And I think that's a process that's just an ongoing dynamic. If there are well-paying jobs to be had, people will still be drawn to them. The fact that local packing houses, just to use that as an example, wound up hiring a lot of these people is probably because of people who had been here for a long time, either became aged and retired, or their children, instead of going into that, were looking for other opportunities. I don't think anybody blocked local people from getting those jobs. Nobody said, oh, you have to be an immigrant in order to be able to have a job here. It's a matter of looking at it. And for those people who came here, they were probably earning more, as low as those wages might seem to many people, than what they were able to get back home. Otherwise, they wouldn't have been here.
Finally, to return to the idea of a separate state. How unified do you think this peninsula is, or do you think it's so diverse that we shouldn't necessarily think of it as a single entity?
Well, if you, I think you were reading the book, so you got through at least a good part of it. I'm an economist by training, and while much of the book is historical in nature, in the end, my economist training crept up in the fore, and I constructed what I call a singularity index,
right.
a way to come to terms with saying, well, how different or how much in common, let's say, do the nine counties of Maryland have with the Western Shore or Delaware or the Eastern Shore of Virginia? And what I see is that the Eastern Shore counties of Maryland, contrary to the fantasies that many people hold, actually has more in common with the Western Shore than, let's say, with Delaware or with the Eastern Shore of Virginia. So I see rising diversity transforming the culture of the region, but I don't find any compelling reason for them to sort of look to the idea that we're going to become a separate state. I might add, because I looked at the attributes on this, I was using the U.S. Census survey, American Community Survey, of a lot of these towns in the area, and per capita income is lower than from any other regions. Life expectancy is lower. And I asked myself, well, suppose if you were to create a separate state of Delmarva, how is that going to affect those important indicators that would be an appealing point, I would think, for anyone to want to live and work here and raise children and to have a satisfactory life? It's something that people are not willing to look at, how much taxation would have to be raised in order to maintain even the existing level, because the Eastern Shore has benefited to some extent from subsidies from the Western Shore. Those are open questions. So my conclusion was,
yes,
it's better to think of Delmarva as a state of mind rather than as a separate political entity. And I don't say that disparagingly or mockingly. I'm simply saying that it's a nice romantic vision for us to have in what I would call a conversation. But the closer I looked, I didn't see any compelling reason for a political realignment, given all the other complexities aside.
We've been speaking with Philip LaBelle. He teaches occasionally here at Salisbury University, makes Delmar his home, and he's author of a new book, A Brief Relation of the State of Delmarva. And we appreciate you stopping by and talking with us.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
This has been Delmarva Today. I'm Don Rush. Thanks for listening.
This has been Delmarva Today, a production of Delmarva Public Radio. Chris Rank produces and is our audio engineer. Don Rush is your host. For podcasts, visit our website, delmarvapublicradio.net, or subscribe to the Delmarva Today podcast on iTunes. Delmarva Today can now be seen on PAC-14. To view the schedule, view the daily times, or visit PAC14.org.